Welcome, everybody. There we go. Recording in progress. So welcome, everybody, to the Geography Showcase. Today, we're going to have undergraduate and master's and PhD students giving brief 5-minute talks about their research. And this is going to be recorded. So the idea is that it's going to go up on the website in the alumni tab so people can watch it for however long it's there. So we might not have many people live, but hopefully many people will be watching it over the next couple of weeks and months. And we do encourage people to ask questions via the chat function. And we're going to answer any of those questions at the very end of everyone's presentation. So there are 8 presentations. And we have some folks who are in the same room. So they'll be sharing Maria Lane's screen and others who are at home. So with that, I think Robert's going to explain a little bit more about the alumni chapter and also some of the competition that's going to be occurring for this round of lightning talks.
Great, thanks, Haley. I just wanted to welcome everyone and thank you all for doing this. One of the things that we've been working on for about 2 years is developing this alumni chapter. And we can feel it gathering lots of momentum. And this kind of activity really helps us do that. The mission of the alumni chapter is to build a network for geography professionals in New Mexico. And the idea of this showcase concept when we can do it in person is that there would be employers and people who could talk about your presentations to other people and just start building our network. So that's the idea. What we're going to do tonight is, as part of the project here, is to time these and see who comes closest to the 5-minute mark. And I'm going to time them. And what we're going to do is figure out the ranking. And then Scott at the Alumni Association has some beautiful prizes that we're going to give out. And what I'll do is meet with him tomorrow and bring them in a box over to the department, and Maria can hand those out. And then we'll post this on the website. So the way the timing is gonna work, and I think if you saw the email I sent out a couple of days ago, Haley's gonna tee you guys up, introduce you, and I'll start the clock when you say, thank you, Haley. And then you'll proceed through your presentation. And then when you're done, you say, now back to you, Haley. And when I hear the last Haley, I'll turn off my stopwatch. So that's just so we go from there. If someone goes 6 minutes or so, I'll politely give you the gong. And if you could just wrap it up pretty quickly from there. And then if there's something you really need to get out during the question phase, we can go from there. So back to you, Haley.
And just a reminder, after you speak, to mute yourselves, though I believe we do have the ability just in case. And since we're going to be sharing screens, I'll ask you to share your screen and just make sure that we're not seeing your notes and everything's okay tech-wise. And then I will introduce you by your name and also the title of the presentation and then let you take it away. So, as I said, there's going to be 8 presentations, and we'll start first with Ramona. So Ramona, if you want to share your screen, and then I'll do a little introduction. Okay, looks good. Great. Okay. Well, first we have Ramona Melzinski, I believe, and her presentation is Mapping Food and Housing Resources for UNM Students. So take it away, Ramona.
Thank you, Haley. My name is Ramona Malchinsky, and I'm a PhD student in the Department of Geography at UNM. I'm also a research assistant for the Basic Needs Security Team, and I'll be talking about mapping food and housing resources for UNM students. Last year in 2020, the Basic Needs Security Team published a report stating that 32% of UNM students are food insecure, and 42% of UNM students are housing insecure. These rates are much higher than New Mexico overall, as well as the US overall. In qualitative research, the Basic Needs Security Team also saw that students don't know how to access food and housing resources, or feel ashamed to access them, thinking that those resources aren't meant for them. I wanted to work on this project to create a map to help students access resources because I have some interest and experience in critical cartography and community engaged geography. The goals of this mapping process were to create a one-stop shop, so an easy map that makes it quick and accessible for people to discern what resources are appropriate for them based on their needs and access limitations. I wanted to make it very easy to find the locations of these resources and include language that assures students that these resources are meant for them. The process began with looking at existing resource guides. I'm going to talk about the Albuquerque Coordinated Resource Guide and a map created by the Sustainability 364 students. Both of these maps have great information, but they're lacking in accessibility, and that's why I wanted to create a separate map just for students. So if you look here, this is the homepage of the CRG, and you can see resources are laid out by type. You can click around and find a screening toolkit, but it's very complicated. There's also text descriptions of each resource, as well as a map of these resources. And the Sustainability 364 students made a map that looks very similar to this. However, you have to do a lot of navigation, and the instructions for how to access these resources aren't on the same web page as the map itself. I also did some informal research talking to the BNS team about what students needed. I talked to previously basic needs insecure UNM students that I'm friends with or have contact with, and I consulted with a homeless shelter worker who is my friend about what a map should look like. This all helped me with my problem and project scope definition. Here is some examples based on my draft map. So as you can see underneath the title, I have some instructions for how to use the map. I wanted to make it quick and easy and also assure students that this map is made for them. I divided the resources into six different categories: on campus, immediate, food and housing, long-term food and housing, for families, and then a tab if you want to get involved with organizations working for food and housing justice. The first example I want to show you is an on-campus resource called the Lobo Food Pantry. I describe each of the resources in this way as location, type, eligibility, required documents, transportation, additional info, and what you need to do when you get to that resource location. Another example of an off-campus immediate food resource is the Transgender Resource Center food bags. So it has the same type of information, so you can easily compare resources across the map and decide which one is best for you. This resource is prioritized for people of a certain population, so that's listed under eligibility. I still have many more resources to map on this map, so if you have any ideas, please let me know. But I am going through that long coordinated resource guide, the sustainability students map, and a binder full of resources from my friend who works at a shelter. My conclusions in this project are that many organizations are doing really great work, but there's still a lot of barriers to access because it's hard to navigate resources. There needs to be central coordination among these organizations by a central institution that gives them resources to update web pages and resource guides. In addition, the Basic Needs Security Team is grateful to help students access resources, but we also hope that larger institutions serving these populations step in to make these resources permanently available to students. If you'd like to contact me, here's my personal email address and the Basic Needs email address. Back to you, Haley.
Perfect. Great. Thank you, Ramona. A very interesting research topic. Okay, so moving right along, because we're going to save any questions to the end, is going to be our second speaker, Yvonne. So Yvonne, if you can share your screen just to make sure we're good on tech before we start introducing you.
Okay.
Looks like the ArcGIS story maps. Is that what you want to show?
Yes. Okay. You can see that.
I can see that. Yes.
Okay.
Okay, great. All right. So our second speaker is Yvonne Morales, and she'll be presenting on renewables for reservations.
Thanks, Haley. I'm Yvonne Morales. I'm an undergraduate at UNM in my senior year. I'll be graduating this semester. And for my capstone project, I was able to research energy independence in Native reservations. And some of the questions I proposed were, where are renewable energy projects located in New Mexico? How will they benefit the Pueblos tribes or Native nations, depending on where they exist? So a little bit of the background. Pueblos in New Mexico have suffered mapping prejudice against their land and resources. From my land management class, I learned that Pueblos lacked basic necessities like clean drinking water, as well as food accessibility and different other things that affected their health. Since working at the Earth Data Analysis Center at UNM, I also noticed that most uranium and coal mines are located near these Pueblos, right outside their neighborhoods. And even though they are located there, a lot of the energy is outsourced, mostly to the inner city. And currently, PNM is looking to shut down units of the San Juan power plant still and switching over to renewable energy. But that's not really a good option for sustainability in the Pueblos just yet. PNM currently employs just under 400 people at the power plant, which also impacts their local economy. And the benefits of renewable energy is that it will create more jobs and overall build in a sustainable option for these communities to have besides relying on coal that also impacts their health.
So through EDAC, I was able to look at a couple mines here. This is Lee Ranch Mine. And most notable about it is mining in the Standing Rock Field has consisted of small open pits just northwest of Lee Ranch Mine and has a rail spur to this operation. So a lot of these mines are being shut down and have caused long-term effects to their health through radiation and aren't mitigated for any sort of cleanup as well. So not only are they not getting the energy, but they're destroying natural resources. Here I also mentioned Crown Point Mine in the Navajo Reservation, Dora Uranium Mine, and the Laguna Pueblo. And these are just a couple of mines located on a map that I specifically georeferenced in EDAC. So they're going to be located where I had circled. This is another map of where I found my resources. And currently there are projects. There are three main projects that are being that are progressing in the Pueblo of Zia and Pueblo of Curis and in the Navajo Nation. Oh, so it would show. And here I also included an interactive map for anybody to access on my story map if they want to go check out the nearest project that is on leased Native American lands. And for the conclusion of my story map is I want to continue furthering my research in this so that I can work with either the Indian Energy or Economic Development Department so I can help move along the project so we don't contribute to more fossil fuels being emitted, especially since we're running out of time. So if anybody has questions, my story map is available to the public and I'll be updating it as I go. So thanks, Haley.
All right, great. Thanks, Yvonne. Appreciate you participating. Our next speaker is going to be Rowan. I believe she is in class with Maria Lane. So I want to give her a moment to come up and share her screen. There she is. Hi, Rowan.
I think she's muted.
Yeah, we'll give her a moment to set up. Okay, we can see the PowerPoint, but still see the notes. There we go. Okay, perfect. All right, are you ready, Rowan?
Yes, thanks, Haley. Okay. So I'm Rowan. I'm a second year geography PhD student in Maria's 603 class. And for my professional experience, I worked on enhancing visitor use monitoring at Petroglyphs National Monument. Visitor use monitoring is a framework that is used by the National Park Service to characterize both the volume and dynamics of visitation that throughout the national park system. And Petroglyph National Monument is looking to update their monitoring plan as part of a broader overhaul of their visitor use management plan, which has been spurred in recent years by increasing development on the west side of Albuquerque, which has led to big increases in use of the park, both in positive and in negative terms, like in this picture that was taken back in 2015 at a location in the park. And so back in January, February, they consulted with a researcher from Kansas State University, Dr. Ryan Sharp, to help them expand their visitor use monitoring methods. And as part of that process, Dr. Sharp got in touch with UNM Geography to see if we would be interested in having an internship program for UNM Geography students to help take some of the load off of the monument staff, as well as just increase connections in the community. I was really interested in getting on the ground floor of helping to design this internship because I'm really interested in participatory methods. It's a thing that's a big part of my research and a part of my career. And so rather than just participating in a project, I was interested in actually designing it and thinking critically about how to create a lasting structure from an organizational perspective. And so I had two main phases to my project. The first one was just conducting a general assessment of what kinds of monitoring are actually happening at Petroglyph right now. So this involved going out into the field with monitoring staff and conducting monitoring with them and conducting interviews to see how this data was being used and if it was being used in some cases and what they hoped to gather from the data that we were collecting out in the field. I also did some readings. I read Dr. Sharp's report on his suggestions for how the monument could enhance its visitor use monitoring. And then I also read the Petroglyph visitor use plan and its current monitoring SOPs to just get a sense of how these methods fit into the broader picture of the visitor use management plan at the park. And then in the second phase of the project, once I had kind of identified the gaps and possibilities for the visitor use monitoring and how UNM students might be able to contribute to it, I started talking with UNM faculty in geography and assessing what kinds of opportunities were available that might fit into existing coursework or existing research programs, and also how this kind of connection might be beneficial to students that were working in various subdisciplines. And then in the second phase, which I'm still kind of working on, is making connections between these two points between the staff at Petroglyphs and then between the faculty here at UNM. And I found that creating multiple points of contact was going to be the best way to ensure that there were both opportunities offered to students every semester, and then also to make sure that the monitoring was completed on a more regular schedule at the monument. And I see a few paths forward for these connections of the monument. The first is with some one-time or low-frequency projects. For instance, the monument is really interested in having their trails resurveyed as they are in the process of overhauling their trail system and closing a lot of social trails and rerouting some existing ones. So that's a slam dunk project, a one-time project for geography students. We're also interested in UAS imaging of some sensitive areas, which is a great annual project for the Aspire Center here at UNM. But then in terms of ongoing monitoring, I see like two different structures for involving students on a regular basis. The first is providing an independent study path for students who are looking for a capstone project or an intensive research experience. And I actually already have a student lined up who is interested in doing this next semester in sustainability studies. And then the second path is through kind of a regular course-based experience, which would involve field work and then maybe a less intensive final project and spread out the labor among a whole class of students. And Kate Lippitt is really interested in incorporating this into her series of field methods classes. And so I think the things that were really successful about this project is taking the time to thoroughly evaluate the current monitoring methods and data usage at the park, and also going in on the UNM side, not with a rigid plan, but iterating it with the faculty and with students as I got to know them, kind of doing interviews on both sides. It's been really tricky trying to connect the two. The schedules are really tricky to coordinate across institutions. And then I think if I could change one thing, I would probably spend a little bit more time looking into other similar projects in different parts of the park system. But overall, I'm really excited that we already have at least one student who's interested in getting out in the field next semester, which is way faster than I thought this would get set up. All right, back to you, Billy.
All right, thanks, Rowan. Great presentation. So our next presentation is going to be Will, and while I let him share his screen, I just want to draw everyone's attention to the chat. Yvonne can't stay till the end for questions, so if you're interested in her story map that she showed during her presentation, she sent the link via chat, so go ahead and copy and paste that if you're interested. But with that, we'll go over to Will Mealy, who is going to be presenting on applications of Python in GIS and data automation.
Thank you, Haley. I'm Will Mealy. I'm a fourth year graduating senior here at the University of New Mexico, graduating with a Bachelor of Science in Geography. And for a capstone project with Maria Lane, I actually investigated automation in GIS and basically using Python to automate certain things to make everybody's job easier. Well, specifically mine, but we'll get into this. And let me switch over here. All right. I work on campus, and for my job, I use an address locator a lot. And a large swath of the data doesn't get matched properly because it will have slight differences in the phrasing. And that just doesn't work for computers, which need everything to be very exact. So I wanted to create a piece of code that would go across a set of data and kind of fix the things that need fixing so that you wouldn't have to do it manually. And my questions were basically, how can I effectively automate this data cleaning? And I also wanted to make sure that I wasn't altering the data in a way that ruined it. And then I wanted to make sure that this piece of code would be compatible with ArcMap, which is, I wanted to represent the data spatially at the end of it. So I needed a version of Python and an interface through which to access it. And so I used Python 3.9. Any version would do if you guys wanted to use this form of automation for your own GIS work. And then I used an integrated development environment called PyCharm, which I would recommend. And then for this investigation, I got census data from the US Census, and I got a shapefile of some data from New Mexico from RGS here at UNM, which is a really good resource. So I looked at what my data needed, and basically with Excel, you want to attach your workbook or your attribute data to spatial data in GIS. So putting the actual like physical data of population or of car crashes or anything like that and putting it to something that people can actually look at and see. And so there were some slight discrepancies. I needed, these said Bernalillo County, comma, New Mexico, and I needed them just to say Bernalillo County, as you can see with the spatial data. So I wanted to, a piece of code that would change the names in the county field. And so basically I ended up writing a piece of code that did just that. This code shouldn't mean anything to anyone. I just wanted to show an example of it. And it prompts the user for the specific workbook and sheet that they want to edit and then how they want to edit specifically. So it is versatile in that way. You can use it on multiple different sets of code or multiple different sets of data. And it utilizes a Python module called OpenPyXL primarily, which deals with opening, editing, and exporting Excel workbooks, which is something that's very useful. And the primary part of this investigation was producing basically this output where everything is formatted correctly. And then I could join it to my spatial data in ArcGIS Online. I originally wanted to use ArcGIS, but or ArcPro, ArcMap, but I ended up moving on to ArcGIS Online, which ended up being pretty useful. So you're able to join it there, and then you can edit the symbology and output a map. Here's a pretty simple map. It's just population by county in New Mexico. But it shows that the data was indeed able to join and I was able to represent it, which is pretty nice. This investigation was largely to improve my ability to use automation in GIS. And it made me a lot more familiar with all of these, but I hope that this investigation has helped demonstrate some different things that you can do in GIS and some different ways that you can use Python to automate geographic processes, which I think is very useful. And it shifted my perspective around how one can use GIS. If I were to go farther, I would perhaps find a way to automate joining the output table to the spatial data in ArcGIS Pro as part of the code itself. That way you don't have to go in and manually do it. And then it also shows to some extent the limitations of coding within Python as minor errors can break things. And that is just some of the limitations of code in general. But overall, I think it was pretty helpful going through all of this. Thank you, everyone. Back to you, Haley.
Great. Thanks, Will. Anything involving Python, I'm always impressed with. So interesting presentation. All right, that has us halfway through. Our next presenter is going to be Brad. And Brad, I like your title. So if you want to go ahead and share your screen. Okay, that looks good. So we have Brad Hansen, and the title of his presentation is Dipping My Toes in Grant Writing and Professional Planning.
Thanks, Haley, and good evening, alumni and fellow map nerds. Like Haley said, my name is Brad. I am in the second year of a geography PhD program at NMSU and UNM, and I'm here today to share with you my experiences this semester as I have explored two professional skill sets, grant writing and professional planning. First off, I'd like to share with you where I'm from. Klamath Basin is the place of my upbringing, and its existence is intimately tied to the historical and present-day stewardship of the Yahooskin, Modoc, and Klamath nations. To them and all of those that shape this place, I am grateful. Not sure if you can tell, but the Klamath Basin is mostly in Southern Oregon, which is not the place that most people think of when they hear Oregon. I'm from east of the Cascade Mountains, where it's high and dry. So think sagebrush and ponderosa pine, not rhododendrons and Douglas fir. Even though my parents are not outdoorsy, the places I grew up in afforded me ample opportunity to grow a relationship with the land and the water. As an undergrad studying geography, I started working as a river guide in the summers, and this dropped me into a watershed that funneled me into becoming an outdoor instructor. Now, I tell you this background because it informs who I have been grant writing for, my vision of professional planning, and how I understand geography. So I started grant writing for Boulder Outdoor Survival School during the pandemic and have continued that work this semester. Last season, we were able to put together our first affinity course because of the outreach and fundraising I took part in. 12 people who are part of the LGBTQ plus community received tuition assistance to come on a course set aside strictly for them. And 21 other people received up to a 50% discount for their course's tuition last season from the same funding. And the grant writing and outreach for next season has already started and it's in full swing. I have written 2 grants so far and I aim to have another one done over winter break. BOSS became a nonprofit in 2018, so our grant writing capacity is growing from infancy to toddlerhood. It felt good to reapply to a local donor this October and build this relationship by sharing firsthand accounts of how their money was spent last season. The importance of building and maintaining relationships is just as evident in professional planning. I became a member of the American Planners Association and through the APA advocated for federal legislation that would bring money to local planners. I participated in 2 Zoom calls with staffers for New Mexican Senator Martin Heinrich and District 2 Representative Yvette Harrell. In these conversations, I aimed to tailor fit the APA's goal with both of the politicians' existing agendas. I was promoting 3 of the acts that were part of the Build Back Better agenda. Of the 3 acts, the Housing Supply and Affordability Act seems like the one that could garner the most bipartisan support. That is because affordable housing is an easy issue to agree on, and it aims to accomplish this by making $1.5 billion available to local planners. The idea of local control and knowledge being used is pragmatic and cuts across party lines. This is important because Representative Harrell is a member of the House who is very distrusting of anything created and supported by Democrats and moderate Republicans. While the Housing Supply and Affordability Act was not part of the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act that was just signed into law by President Joe Biden yesterday, there were some provisions in that legislation that the APA supports, which I can give you details on if there's interest during the Q&A. The Build Back Better legislation is still being negotiated in Congress. My geographic understanding of what local planners needed funding for played a key role in my ability to explain how this aligned with 2 very different political agendas. Different types of relationship building and geographic understanding were interwoven into these conversations. As geographers, we are trained and skilled at going deep into the pragmatic questions of who is where, why are they there, and why should we care? We are not interdisciplinary academic oddities or generalists who lack deep understanding. As I have become more proficient as a geographer, my ability to perceive and understand relationships has followed suit. This more than anything has provided me with success in grant writing and learning about professional planning this semester. Like rivers, relationships are very dynamic and ever-changing. Understanding the migrating cycles of this amazing place called Earth and being able to express my observations of them helps me perceive, create, and maintain the relationships I am embedded within. Whether we know it or not, we all have an unfulfilled desire, that is a purpose. Mine seeks protection for who I love as danger and chaos abound. It takes faith, trust, and compassion to face the unknown and plants the seeds of hope. We must be ready to work, to be resilient and resolved to attain the harvest we seek. Thanks for listening, and I'm happy to take any questions if we have time at the end. Back to you, Haley.
Great. Thank you, Brad. You had some great graphics in there. As Brad mentioned, again, please type any questions in the chat. We do have several, which is great to see, and we'll get to them at the end. But our next presenter is going to be Lindsay. If you can share your screen, Lindsay. Okay, looks like we're seeing, yep, all right. So the next presenter is Lindsay Rocci, and her topic is mapping avalanche risks. Take it away, Lindsay.
Thanks, Haley. So this is work for my thesis for my master's degree. And just starting off with what avalanches are, there's 2 main types, loose snow and slab avalanches, but I'm focusing on slab avalanches for this. Those are the big ones that cause a lot of destruction and tend to kill the most backcountry people. So what people are really worried about. These occur when you have an added weight which is either probably new snow or a person that triggers a break on a weak layer, and then just a big slab of a bunch of snow goes downhill really fast. And as soon as it settles, it turns into concrete. It's not like jumping out of a snow pile. You have to be dug out pretty much every inch of it. 95% of avalanches that catch humans were triggered by them or someone in their party. So it's really important that we understand where the avalanche hazard is if you're going out in the backcountry for recreation in the winter. The big influences are topography, weather, and snowpack. I'm focusing on topography because weather and snowpack are super dynamic, changing hourly. I can talk more about mapping that later if there's time. So the big thing is, why do we care? Avalanches don't affect the same number of people as hurricanes and earthquakes and the big disasters you think of like that, but they have a super high frequency in the environments that they occur in. And if you're caught in one, the fatality rate is super high. So with increasing popularity of winter backcountry recreation, it's really important that we get accessible avalanche hazard information out to the public. This past ski season had the deadliest week in US history for avalanches, and there were 37 fatalities in the US. So looking at where do avalanches happen, this is those topographic factors I was talking about. The really big one is slope. You mainly see them in 30 to 45 degree slopes. But there are other factors that can affect them. So vegetation density, trees that are less than 500 trees per hectare, you can have avalanches. More than that, they'll anchor the snow and they help with the snowpack. Generally speaking, 500 trees per hectare or less is what people like skiing through. Aspect is going to be dependent on the season and the wind. So that is a fairly dynamic variable that will be included. In the winter, your shadier aspects are more likely to slide. In the spring, your sunnier aspects are more likely to slide. And then wind, the leeward side of the slope is more likely because of all that extra wind loading and weight causing stress on the snow. You're most likely to get avalanches within 100 meters of a ridge, and the smoother the surface is, the easier it is for the snow to slide on it. So what maps currently exist, when someone goes out to go backcountry skiing or snowmobiling or snowshoeing, they're probably going to look at one of these maps if they're interested in avalanche hazard. This is slope shading, so where an avalanche is likely to start based off of that slope, which was the biggest factor. So those reds and oranges are that 30 to 45 degree slope where you're likely to see it. Once you get into the purples, that's cliffs where you're not going to get avalanches because snow can't settle on it long enough. It's too steep. So what's the problem with this? Start zones aren't the only danger, and that map is only showing start zones. So if there's someone above you that triggers an avalanche and you're in that run out below, you're in just as much danger. Also, connected slopes can slide. So I said 30 to 45 degrees is where you really get avalanches, and that's true. That's by far the most likely. But if you're on a slope that's lower than that, but connected to, say, that 35 degree slope, which is prime slides, that 26 degree slope right next to it can also slide because it changes the stressors. And then the other thing is, these models are just a representation of reality. We try to get as close as we can, but nothing's perfect. So when you have those hard and fast lines that were in that map, something, it can seem like you're safe, but you're really not. There's an interesting case study on that. That I can share. And then it's not just slope. So like I said, slope is the biggest, but there's that vegetation density aspect, topographic roughness, and distance to ridges that are also all really affecting that. So what am I doing? I'm creating a new start zone susceptibility layer that's going to include distance to ridges, topographic roughness, and vegetation density and aspect. And then once I have that start zone susceptibility, I can make my start zones and model run out to all the spots where the avalanche would actually run into, and looking at connected slopes. And then finally, this is going to be visualizing some uncertainty. So there aren't going to be hard and fast lines, but the map's going to use gradient shading and showing that it's not perfect. Thanks. That's my sources. Back to you, Haley.
Thanks, Lindsay. That was really interesting. Are you a skier by chance? Is that why you picked avalanche?
Yeah, I'm a snowboarder and a ski patroller, so
cool. Great. Thank you. Okay, our next two presenters actually are in the room with Maria, so we'll give them a moment to walk up. And just a reminder to turn on the camera and the microphone when you guys are ready, Daniel and Dana. There you are.
Hi.
You got at least one to share.
Yeah, I will. Sorry. I just wanted to make sure that you can see.
Yeah, take your time. Do not worry about it.
Okay.
Perfect. Okay, so our next two presenters are Daniel Bean and Dana Dominguez. And the title of their presentation is HEMA's Forest Mapping for BIA Compliance.
Okay, thank you, Haley. So yeah, hi, I'm Daniel Bean. I'm a student in the New Mexico Geography PhD program. My classmate Dana Dominguez and I are going to speed run through the details of a project we did for Pueblo Pemez to map and inventory all of their forest land. Incidentally, large swaths of New Mexico are occupied indigenous lands, and so we acknowledge that our education and work occurs in those occupied places. So, I'll provide a bit of background on the project. Historically, the BIA has overseen forest inventories on tribal lands, but just recently they delegated that activity back to the tribes, all while maintaining, oversight and stipulating the format and quality of those maps. So the HEMA's Natural Resources Department is in direct communication with the BIA, the branch of Forest Resources and Planning, as you can see in this nested diagram. Dana and I, on behalf of the PhD program, are subcontractors to the Pueblo to provide all mapping services for them per BIA standards. And so we signed a contract which broadly states that we're expected to produce a single data file that groups all land covered by dominant vegetation classes into polygons. and then describe the characteristics of both the dominant overstory and dominant understory present in each polygon. So the attributes listed on the right were defined in astonishing detail by the BIA. And essentially, they want to be able to assess the extent of forest loss to fire and cutting, and to prioritize places where timber activity can reasonably continue while also ensuring a healthy forest. And I'll pass it off to Dana.
Thank you, Daniel. So to give you all an overview of the workflow and methods we use, Daniel and I devised a plan that allowed us to divide and conquer the workload that existed between using two big data sets that we would then fuse downstream. So Daniel focused on processing the LIDAR while I worked on processing of the NAEP imagery and creating of additional imagery layers. We then combined some of the LIDAR raster data with the remote sensing data for classification. This vegetation focus classification, in addition to more LIDAR data, was then utilized by Python code written by Daniel that was able to create and assign polygons of a specific size with percent primary cover type. And then our attributes were assigned manually based on visual inspection of the final GIS product layer. So going into the project, we knew we would hone skills in remote collaborations and communications while applying our skills in classification, code writing, and handling of these large data sets in the real world. The implications of these skills, the implementation of these skills was far more involved than we initially planned and led to major delays in some respects. So one of those delays was planning for processing and the time due to size and slow computations. And we did plan for that, but what we didn't plan for was reprocessing and redoing those classifications when we wanted to tweak something. And so that would add an additional week every time we tweaked it, or if it just failed after getting 90% through. So Daniel, would you like to talk about communication complications?
Yeah. So regarding communication, we had a bit of a hangup where it started to look and feel like our contacts at the Pueblo started to think of me as the point person, which wasn't the case. And so Dana and I first had to have a conversation together about what possibly led to that, and then take those concerns back to the tribe to kind of gently set the record straight. And this was a really important object lesson in like having clear communication up front that had we left unaddressed, it could have turned into a real problem.
Thanks. So in closing, Daniel and I were able to assist the Pueblo of Jemez in creating a map for management of forested lands via a digitized data set of land cover types that you can see the example of here. We did this using the workflow that handled the fusion of multiple big data sets, and we learned to foresee and pre-plan for delays. Now back to you, Haley.
Okay, thank you, Daniel and Dana. That was great. And all of a sudden we are at our last presenter, but definitely not least. So Desiree, if you can share your screen whenever you're ready. All right, it looks like it's just your background of the desktop right now. There you go. Okay, so our next and last presenter is Desiree Loggins, and the title of her presentation is A Critical Story Mapping of the Historic El Camino Real de Tierra Adentro in New Mexico.
Hi, everyone. My name is Desiree Loggins, and I'm a second year master's student in the Department of Geography and Environmental Studies. And I'm also a project assistant for the Center for Community Geography. And I help support a collaborative mapping effort in partnership with the National Trails National Park Service to produce a tool that would share the history and narratives made possible by the Camino Real de Tierra Adentro National Historic Trail, which is also known as the Royal Road of the Interior. So some background, the center, the R.H. Mallory Center, name might be familiar, for geography, community geography is affiliated with the Department of Geography and Environmental Studies, and it supports community engaged research and learning focused on critical human environment issues and relationships in New Mexico. We engage directly with community groups and student and faculty partners to achieve our mission. And in this overview, I'm just going to demonstrate to you how one of our collaborations worked. So the El Camino is a network of trails stretching from modern day Mexico City all the way north to Okehuenge Pueblo. Indigenous peoples forged these footpaths and corridors many years ago for travel and trade, and Spanish colonizers and settlers later established El Camino Real as one of the many royal roads connecting Spanish centers of authority like Mexico City to distant frontiers in so-called New Spain. And so legacy and access to the historic trail, which you may have seen signs for all around the Albuquerque area, is managed by a team of interpreters, historians, and data scientists at National Trails National Park Service. They're interested in creating a digital interpretive tool through Esri story maps that would connect New Mexicans to the trail while also engaging with student learners. So the center partnered the National Trails team with students in critical cartography. The class is taught by center director, Dr. Maria Lane, and it explored the critical nature of maps and mapping, focusing on maps as tools of communication, action, and power. And so we would argue this was a pretty perfect match. Students read critical cartographic theory and participated in group discussion in the classroom for the first half of the semester, and then got outside to explore the living connections along El Camino to produce two Esri story maps, all the while receiving support and Esri training from National Trails in the center. The first story map examines the role of agriculture along El Camino. Students wanted to make sure that we were mapping the crops grown and traded along El Camino's route. And the second map focuses on transportation's evolution along the El Camino, and Ramona and Will actually are authors of this one. So you can also direct some questions to them. Each map described the history of their respective topics and illustrated those histories using photos from their own student site visits and archived photos from NPS and the Library of Congress. And of course, they created traditional maps to orient users to the trail, detail specific locations and events, and make sure community members knew that the trail was not dead or a metaphor, but a living historic element of New Mexico's history that they could visit and connect to. One of the elements that I think is quite engaging are the oral histories embedded in each map. Students interviewed staff from community-centered organizations working along the trail. In my role, I also added interviews and other engaging elements after the class ended to complete the maps. This included farmer interviews recorded by the students from the Heritage Farming Practicum taught by Brady McCartney. The interviews expanded our attentive collaboration by reaching more organizations and produced a community-minded and dynamic story project. So together we created really beautiful, engaging, and critical story maps for everyone to enjoy and learn from. Additionally, one student, Ramona, who is presenting, went on to work for the National Trails team in the summer. The maps are very close to being published. The National Trails team is making sure it meets all of their publishing guidelines. And so we'll announce when they are live soon. And if you want to be alerted to when that happens, please email us to be added to the center mailing list. So thank you for listening to that short preview. Please keep in touch. Funding is available for faculty and students through our website. Contact us for more information or just follow us on social media and look out for critical cartography being available this upcoming spring. Thanks, back to you, Haley.
Okay, great. Thank you, Desiree. Good job, everyone. We do have about four questions. I think I will ask the questions for folks who are on virtually, and then if Ramona and Rowan, if you guys can make your way up to the front of the classroom, and I'll ask you guys last, you have some time. But I think, Desiree, we can start with a question for you since you just presented. There we go. Okay. Are the story maps publicly available and something that might be able to use in my classes? And by my classes, this is for Mary Gold.
Yes, so the story maps are not available yet, but they will be available any day now. It's really just making sure that they are publishable. The NPS is a government agency, and so there are a lot of specific things they need to make sure are all good with the story maps before they're published to their websites. And from there, anyone can use them, work through them. And there's also the student author names on them. So if you have any questions for some of the authors to provide additional context, I think you'll be able to do that.
Okay, thanks, Desiree. And I lied, there's actually five questions that I'm gonna ask, not four. So the next one is for you, Lindsay. And the question is, why are we more likely to see an avalanche near to ridges?
That's kind of a two-part thing. So one part is related to the aspect with the wind loading. So snow can be transported way faster with wind than it can just coming out of the sky. So you get a whole bunch of wind loading on that leeward side, which is going to be at the top of the ridge, where you also have cornices, which are where, if you ever are in snowy, windy mountains and you see how they kind of look like a wave going over, those cornices can break easily, and all that wind-loaded snow is extra weight. And then also the big stress on the snow is at the top, because all the snow that's connected to it below is pulling downhill. So the highest stress points are up top near the ridge too.
That makes a lot of sense. Thank you. Okay, the next one is for you, Will, and for everyone who's watching this later on. As a reminder, Will's presentation was the applications of Python and GIS in GIS and data automation. And the question is, how will you use these skills after you graduate next spring, Will?
Yeah, so I think they have pretty broad application. I'm not sure if I will use this specific set of code again, but the tangible skills I've learned, I think will help me when I get a job in the GIS field, I'll, take that on in my knowledge in Python to help code and automate things in the future.
Yes, when you will. Yeah. Okay, two more questions, one for Ramona and one for Rowan. So I don't know if, Ramona, if you can come on up. So the question is, will some resources be placed in multiple categories, for example, in both on-campus resources and immediate food?
Yeah, so I'm using ESRI Shortlist, which is a type of ESRI story map. So it's related to what Desiree was presenting. And I thought that you could categorize tabs into subcategories, like I think Marigold was asking that question. I was thinking that there was ways to do that, but it seems like you can only categorize it based on tabs. So I have to think of like problem solve a little bit more on that. So if anyone can think of an idea, maybe putting a prefix at the top of the title could work, or changing the picture for each tile. That might be a way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. And then our last question is going to be for Rowan, and then Robert is going to read out the timing for everyone, and we'll see who was closest to 5 minutes. So Rowan, how does your project connect to your master's work, and is this part of your thesis?
So this project actually is completely separate from my dissertation work, but it bears a lot of similarities in terms of working on participatory methods with federal agencies, and so I found it to be really valuable toward my dissertation work in that respect.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Marigold, for the majority of the questions. I appreciate it. It's always better than me coming up with some. So since we're close to the top of the hour, I think, Robert, if you want to go through the presentation and let us know the timing.
Okay. Well, first off, I'd like to thank everyone because I think that was absolutely fantastic. And I'm just thrilled with how it turned out. So number one was Ramona, and she came in at -1 second and -1.28. Number two was Brad. He came in at -2.48. Number three was Yvonne. She came in at +3 seconds, 3.81 seconds. Number four was Daniel and Dana. They came in at +4.25 seconds. Number five was Will. He came in at +9.58 seconds. Number six was Lindsay. She came in at +12.80 seconds. Number seven was Desiree. She came in at -26.45 seconds. And Rowan was number eight. She came in at +57. So what we did is we took five minutes, and then we counted back forwards and backwards for the, so we use not a five as the median. So what we need, and you can just email one of us, is for Ramona, we need your t-shirt size. Don't have to tell us now. That could be an Alumni Association. So with that, for my part of the closing, and then Haley, I'll hand it back to you. I'd like to wish all of you a wonderful Thanksgiving, and also be sure to put this on your resumes, because this is the kind of thing that it's something that shows that you can public speak about your project. So thank you very much, and back to you, Haley.
Yes, good job, everyone. It's really hard to speak about a whole research project or interest in just 5 minutes, and we really appreciate you participating. I'm going to do my own little plug for the Alumni Association. We're still pretty new. Robert has done a great job of getting it off the ground, but we always need new members. So if you're thinking, or not thinking, if you are graduating anytime soon, please consider joining at my office, which is the Southwest Environmental Finance Center. I was a graduate of the program, the geography program, in 2018 with my master's. And since then, we have collected several geography majors, Tucker, Shannon, who I believe just graduated, and also Luke, who is currently part of the program. So we're always, you know, interested in looking for geographers to hire. And if you come over to the Alumni Association, you'll hear about more job opportunities as well. And so hopefully we'll do maybe a showcase a year, at least a couple events each year. So please be on the lookout for that. But otherwise, thank you for spending your Tuesday evening with us, and we really appreciate it.